The boss! Hey, boss! It's time for Dumpsterpiece Theatre!
Oh, shut up, boy. I'm trying to take a Dumpsterpiece Theatre. Thank you very much.
Stupid old song.
Yep, exactly, and it's high time for it, I'm here to tell you.
I think so.
We're very happy to be here tonight because, well, for once, we've found a decent film to show you, so we're really kind of proud, aren't we, Alfonso?
That's right.
Yes, exactly. We're going to go back to the old crime films, or in this particular case, a film noir from 1950 called Quicksand, starring Mickey Rooney and Jeannie Cagney.
I must say, at this point, there will be no computer-generated graphics in this film.
Well said, well said.
Don't need them.
Don't need them here. Actually, this film has a story, which is...
Because it was 1950, you know.
Yes, yes. The story was by Robert Smith, not of The Cure, by the way. And also stars Peter Lorre in a very amusing role. Lorre was at his height being a bad guy, and he's a particularly sleazy arcade owner in this.
He's lots very good.
Yes. But actually, the highlight of this film was and still is Mickey Rooney, who was at the end of his contract days at MGM by this time and was looking for more adult roles. And he found one in this. This was the film he did after The Big Wheel in 1949. He did this for Irving Pichel, a director who later went on to his greatest fame was Destination Moon. But I digress. I want to get back to Rooney because I remember a lot of critics at the time period really started ragging on Rooney. Said, oh, he'd be nothing but a juvenile, blah, blah, this and that.
Andy Hardy grows up.
Yeah, Andy Hardy grows up and leaves home and gets mad or whatever the hell. You know, critics couldn't let that go. Instead, what they did was they missed a very interesting series of films which started with The Big Wheel. And certainly by this time, Quicksand is a marvelous little item. It's your classic film noir, your typical noir, I should say, where the hero is your average guy. He's just a decent fellow, post-war veteran, who for once has a decent job and is earning a good living, very happy with life. But he meets...
Hey, may I?
Oh, yes, by all means.
Okay. Tonight's film is... It's a cautionary tale on karma and how it can turn around and bite you on the ass.
Exactly. Well put, Alfonso. A little graphic, but he does hit the point.
There's a valuable lesson to be learned in this film.
Yes.
And that is, ain't no woman worth $20.
Good point.
You just gotta see it, man.
Yes.
This is a great
film.
Oh,
yes. Although, no, I'm not even gonna say that. We were talking about that earlier, but we'll veer away from that arena.
Vera?
Vera.
Vera
is her name, by the way.
Yeah, we're talking about Vera.
Vera is the femme fatale. She's also one of the film noir metaphors. She is part of the quicksand of the title. She is the one that metaphorically pulls Rooney down into a quagmire of just a lot of bad mistakes. There's no doubt about this. But it's very interesting film. We hope you enjoy it. Like I say, this is really a very decent showcase for Mickey Rooney, who I believe in this film and several others, like The Atomic Kid was a lot of fun in the 50s, written by Blake Edwards.
So but, who else is in this thing, man?
Oh, yes. Well, let's see. Oh, that's right. The some of the supporting characters, very interesting collection of people. Wally Cassell playing one of his friends, Chuck. At the beginning, you'll see him in the diner, and no one less than the legendary Jimmy Dodd. Alfonso, I think Jimmy Dodd is your territory.
Oh yeah, yeah. He was Jimmy on the Mouseketeers on the Mickey Mouse Club.
Exactly, that's the same guy.
Yeah, yeah. Quite a gifted guitar player, musician. He wrote the Mickey Mouse March.
Wow, I didn't know that.
Yeah, that's true.
Well, that's cool. All right, very talented man. If I can find it, we'll try to show you a music video we did back in the 40s, 1944 to be exact, called Stop That Dancing Up There, a really nice little duet number he does. And if we can find that, we'll show it. If not, at least it shows you that Jimmy Dodd was musical through most of his career.
Well, yeah, yeah, especially during a certain series called the Three Mesquiteers, or the Three Mesquiteers.
Yeah, very, very interesting cowboy pictures.
He played Lullaby Joslin, singing cowboy.
There's a name. Oh, he was the singing cowboy?
Yes, he was.
Oh, cool. All right. Way to go, Jimmy. Yeah. And then something like The Three Mesquiteers, which actually at that time was a very popular series of westerns, which initially John Wayne was one of the Three Mesquiteers, but he went on to bigger fame with Republic. But I think later on, Crash Corrigan, Bob Treherne, Robert Livingston, I believe, was the essential trio. And Jimmy Dodd was actually a recurring character.
Yeah.
That's
yeah,
very good.
Yeah, he did several of them.
That's another one I didn't know.
Yeah.
All
yeah,
right.
Now, and boys and girls out there, you may or may not know what the hell we're talking about when we're talking about these Three Mesquiteers or Mesquiteers.
Classic.
But it was the basis of a film starring Chevy Chase,
yes, and
Martin Short,
and
Steve Martin.
You bet.
Called the Three Amigos.
You knew who we were talking about. All right, that's a very interesting piece of cinema history.
Why did Jimmy Dodd do this film we're watching tonight?
Well, I give up. Why?
Because he had to.
He's right. Anyway, I guess we have to get to the picture. We should get to the first reel before we blab and give it all away. But we essentially want you to just keep an eye on this thing, because this is actually one of the better films we've shown on Dumpsterpiece Theater. Actually, probably doesn't deserve the dump of the title, but hey, enjoy it anyway. Here it is, reel number one of Quicksand with Mickey Rooney, Jeannie Cagney, and Peter Lorre. What?
None.
Oh, okay.
That was terrible.
It was?
Oh, your Cagney imitation.
Oh.
I thought I was brilliant, though.
Here we go.
Fresh. See, that's how you do it. Fresh.
Not bad.
Good around here, but there's a big run of marlin up Tijuana.
Yeah?
Taking a party down there Sunday morning. How do you like this guy? Gets paid to go fishing while we slave over a hot carburetor.
You cynic. Hey, Dan, we got room for one more. Why don't you come along?
When are you going to get back?
Late Monday night.
Monday night, that lets me out. I couldn't get Monday off.
You could get away if you wanted to. You just don't want to miss spending Sunday with a girlfriend.
Helen?
No, they busted up a couple of months ago. By the way, she called you again this morning.
She did?
I told her you wasn't in for the 19th time.
Good, good.
How do you like this guy?
There's a dame I trade my right arm for, and he gives her the runaround.
Maybe he's found a new dish.
No, I spent 4 years in the Navy fighting for freedom. Why get anchored down now? Besides, she was getting too serious.
Your wedding belt, huh?
She gets louder and louder. Yeah, I figured she's too nice to string along. But she won't take no for an answer.
Some dames are sure hard to shake off. I once knew a blonde.
And her name
was Margie.
How'd you know?
We've heard the story a dozen times.
A couple of dozen times. Hey, we better be getting back or old man Mackie will blow a fuse.
Right. Here, that's for you. You new here, honey?
55 out of a dollar.
What time you get off tonight? 6:30? 7?
Don't forget your change.
I happen to have my autograph book here with me. Name and address?
I'm afraid you've made a mistake. I don't come with the merchant's lunch.
Oh, now don't be like that. I think you're wonderful. Anything wrong in that?
No, but...
Well, then I'll let you and me tonight, huh?
I work tonight.
Till when?
Till 9:30.
You like Red Nichols in his outfit?
Yeah, I think they're great.
They're playing over at the music bar on the pier. I thought I'd pick you up after 9:30 and we'd go over and give them a listen, okay?
Okay.
See you tonight.
$75?
Hey, Chuck. I just remembered something.
Remembered what?
It's 5 days until payday and I'm flat busted. How you holding?
I'm crouching.
Me too. Well, I gotta figure out some way to get some Gitas, or how else am I gonna take that gorgeous creature out to the music bar?
Why don't you ask old man Mackie for an advance?
Oh, that old guy, he wouldn't give you the sweat off his glasses.
Yeah, he's sure a mean old buzzard.
Hey, Buzzard, I'm glad you said that. Buzz Larson owes me $20.
Why don't you call him up down at the dock?
My friend, you have just read my mind. Hello, is Buzz Larson there, please? Oh, hello, Buzz. Hi, boy, this is Danny. Listen, could you let me have that $20 you owe me? Oh, that's swell. Believe me, you're a lifesaver. I'll be down tonight and pick it up. Huh? Tomorrow? Oh, wait a minute, boy, I need it right away. You don't get paid until tomorrow. Now, I understand, sure. Okay. All right, thanks anyway, kid. Bye.
Who left that light on in the washroom?
Not me.
Well, it was one of you fellas. You're all alike. You don't care what you do with my money. You think I own stock in the power company?
One moment, please. And then I said, yes, it's the supervisor speaking.
Helen Colgan, are you listening to me?
Yeah.
I don't think you've heard one word. You just seem to be walking around in a dream lately.
Oh, Millie, I think I'll say goodbye to you here. There's some things I have to get.
What things? Where?
Oh, just some things. Over on State Street.
I know where you're going, Helen. And you're making a big mistake. If he wants to see you, he knows your telephone number.
I know, but I...
But nothing. You're making a fool of yourself.
I think I am. Goodbye.
Well, when you need it fast, sometimes you haven't got time.
A lineup.
What?
A standard lineup.
Yeah, okay. No, not you, Red. Yeah, sure. Well, if you haven't got it, you can't lend it. Yeah, all right. Thanks a lot. Bye.
Reach Buzz?
Yeah, I called him, Ray Pearson, Jimmy Cook, all of them. None of them had it.
Too bad.
$1.03?
Exact same.
There you go.
Nobody checks my cash except this once-a-week bookkeeper, and he don't come around till Thursday. I could put it back before Thursday. I could put it back tomorrow, as soon as I get that $20 from Buzz.
Yeah, how's every little thing?
Just fine.
That's good. I'll see you later, huh?
Have you been dancing lately?
Yeah, I went last Saturday.
Do you ever go hiking anymore?
Once in a while.
Do you remember the Sunday we hiked up Pioneer Canyon?
Yeah.
Didn't we have fun?
Yeah, we had lots of fun.
Well, Danny, will you give me a ring sometime?
Sure, I'll give you a ring. We'll get together real soon. I'll see you later. I'll give you a ring soon. Taxi lady?
Where'd you meet her?
I'll figure out the fare as we go along.
You might overcharge me.
I might at that. Hop in, honey. Where'd you like to go?
Let's go downtown. Window shopping.
How dull can you get?
Well, that's what I want to do. We can do something else later.
You have a deal, honey.
Still here.
Nice looking coat. But they'd suck you at least $1,000 for a coat like that.
Are you kidding? Why, that's mink. It's a bargain at $2,000. Isn't that the most beautiful thing you've ever seen in your life?
Well, it's not bad. Are you thinking on buying it?
I want that coat. And I'm going to get it.
For $2,000?
For whatever it takes.
Say, wait a minute. You really do want it, don't you?
You bet I do. I'm kidding.
Wait a minute.
Huh?
Oh, they're
blue.
Brown. Yeah, but there's blues in your big brown eyes.
Oh, you sing too.
Only for you, honey.
Shall we go?
Closed Mondays. How do you like that?
Are you sure you didn't happen to know it was closed when you invited me?
Now, wait a minute. Would I do a thing like that? I'll take any place you want to go. Name it, you can have it.
All right. All right. I know a place where I'd like to go.
You.
Give me a nickel, Danny. I'll show you how to beat this game.
Wait a minute.
Oh. One ball. Hey, Nick, pay me. I hit the jackpot.
Hey. All for you.
Hey, wait a minute. Go ahead, honey. Play as much as you want.
Take it easy, Danny. I can handle Nick myself. I used to work here. Didn't I, Nick?
Yeah. Did you come back, huh?
Still in the window, Nick. Saw it yesterday.
Are you crazy? What do you think I am, a millionaire?
What's going on here?
Let's skip it. Come on, we'll have our pictures taken. Come on. See you later, Nick.
Who goes first?
We both go.
What do you want?
Give me a half a buck's worth of nickels.
Okay, Admiral. Now what do you want?
There's only 9 nickels there, buddy.
Yeah? Who's cheating who?
What?
Look, you got your nickel, haven't you? Hit the road.
Why, hello, Nick.
Look, I've got rules in this house. That goes for you, too. If you want to pull that kind of stuff, go somewhere else. Come on, beat it. Beat it.
Come on, Vera, let's get out of this crummy joint.
Goodbye, Nick. That big star right there?
Yeah.
It says Beetlejuice.
Who?
Beetlejuice. Beetlejuice, Dave used to call it.
Dave? Who's Dave?
Oh, a fella I used to know. He taught me the names of all the stars. You know, I never saw a star until I was 16.
How come?
I was raised in Steeltown, West Virginia, and you couldn't see the sky for the smoke. So I ran away.
Funny, I ran away more, too. That was a long, long time ago. What'd you do after you ran away from home?
Oh, I was a car hop for a while, waitress in a beer joint, clerk in a 5 and 10, cashier in a coffee shop. It's not what you run away to, it's what you run away from.
I ran away from a farm and the belt the old man used to whip me with. That old man was sure free with that belt.
Oh, I ran away from a lot of things.
Ma getting drunk all the time and never having any decent clothes to wear. And the boarders, especially those boarders. They wouldn't leave me alone.
Must have been tough.
I learned to handle them after a while.
Think you can handle me?
Sure. I can handle you easy.
Yeah.
Welcome back to Dumpsterpiece Theatre. Alfonso and I are really proud to be showing you tonight Quicksand, starring Mickey Rooney, Jeannie Cagney, Barbara Bates, and Peter Lorre.
No actual quicksand in the movie.
In that order. Oh, no. Quicksand is a metaphor, which is typical of most film noir of that time period. You know, crossfire, deadlock, railroaded. It was all one-word titles, metaphors for that descent into darkness, which is typical of the genre.
They didn't even have to call it quicksand, right?
No. Well, you know, there could have been some other titles for it, I think.
Yeah, like Snowball.
Yeah, or Dumbass.
Yeah, Dumbass.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, Mickey Rooney's a real dumbass in this one.
Yeah, because actually, in the beginning now, you've seen how it's getting ready to take off. He's pulled one little slip up to go out with Jeannie Cagney, who... you'll see her true colors later on, but now we're getting into the true quicksand of the title, and things are going to get interesting. Speaking of interesting things, I'd like to remind you a little bit more of the director, Irving Pichel, who was really starting to enjoy a career in directing at this time period. I believe at the same year, he was best known for directing George Pal's Destination Moon, which is, of course, a wonderful treat. The first color science fiction film of the 50s.
That's that one with Woody Woodpecker in it, right?
That's it. That's the one where Woody explains rocket propulsion to all these potential investors. So that was Irv Pichel as far as directing goes. Always loved that film. I like Quicksand, too. We'll try to find more of his work. And if that name sounds familiar to all you folks who remember actors in the 30s, Irving Pichel was in Dracula's Daughter. No, he didn't play the daughter. He played her servant. So anyway, he was on both sides of the camera, but made a heck of a good director. And, of course, you also saw Jeannie Cagney. She plays Vera in this, the film noir babe who's going to get darker and darker all the time. And, of course, she is part of the famous Cagney family. She's James Cagney's little sister.
That's right. You know, I seen her in Man of a Thousand Faces playing James Cagney's sister, I believe, Carrie Chaney.
Wow, that's right. And Cagney played Lon Chaney. Well, wow, that's kind of neat. Yeah.
Oh, brother. Bit, oh, sister.
A little bit
oh,
of
nepotism.
Nepotism there. Yeah, that's strange. Yeah, and she was one of the Cagneys you didn't see very much. James, at that time, was starting to get back into the crime films, so it was kind of interesting they got paired in a biography later on. But at that time, Cagney's older brother, William, was producing his film, so you know, it was like family circle all the way around. So
I always liked the imitations, like, you know, Rich Little and them would do. Okay,
yeah.
Cagney.
Yeah. Oh, no, that's Edward G. Robinson.
That's G, man.
Yeah, Edward G.
Yeah, it's a... You dirty rat.
Oh.
That hits home to me.
Yeah, I guess. Now, were you offended by that, or is...
Oh, not at all.
Okay, now see...
We're all dirty.
Yep, so all you political correct people out there, if it doesn't offend Alfonso, it won't offend anybody. So there.
That's right!
That's right, so heck with that. Now, one other thing we'd like to remind you before we get back into the movie is right at the end of this next segment, when Jeannie Cagney and Mickey Rooney go out to the... a hot night spot, they're going to see a band, Red Nichols and his Five Pennies. Now, even though that sounds like a script or made up
name. That's their name?
It sure is. That's actually the real name. There was a real band, Red Nichols and his Five Pennies. Very popular jazz at that time. He is a part of what was later becoming known as the West Coast Jazz, which featured people like old Shorty Rogers and his Giants, Shelly Mann and his Men. He was in that ilk and did really well as a dance band. And you'll see they pretty hot band in this segment coming up. So I guess instead of talking about it, we're going to let you get right to it. Here we go. Act number two of
Quicksand.
And watch it. He's going to get swallowed up. By the quicksand.
Quicksand, yeah. By the quicksand.
Yes.
Hello, is Buzz there? He what? Took a fishing party. How, when will he be back? No, never mind. All right, I'll call him later. Bye.
The bookkeeper. What's he doing here 2 days ahead of time? If he finds out, I'm sure he'll tell the old man. The old man's mean enough to send a guy to jail just for laughs. I gotta get $20 in a hurry. How about that salary loan outfit? The one that's always yakking on the radio. Walk in with an honest face, walk out with a pocket full of dough. I must have walked in with the wrong face. A couple of days to check my references. I haven't got any references, and I haven't got a couple of days.
For a dollar down, like it says in the window?
As soon as we check up on your credit.
Credit? Oh. I can't wait that long.
Oh, wait a minute. You got a charge account in town?
No. Yes, I have. At the hub. At the hub where I buy my clothes.
I tell you what I'll do. I'll call their credit manager, and if he says you're okay, you can take the watch right with you. Okay? Now, there, let's get it on and show you what it looks like.
How much could you let me have on this ticker?
$30 do you any good?
$30 will be fine.
Any better than last week?
I don't know yet, Mr. Mackey. I'll let you know.
Well, about that other matter, see if you can't find a way to make it a business deduction.
I'll think about it, Mr. Mackey.
Hi, George.
Hi, Dan.
You're here kind of early this week, aren't you?
The old man sent for me. Had some tax reports for me to get out.
Oh.
And I figured as long as I was here, I'd get my Thursday work done. Say, Dan, I just checked the register and it's $20 short.
Well, maybe you could have made a mistake or something.
No, I checked it twice.
Well, you know, sometimes the money gets stuck in the money sack down there. Yeah, here it is. See?
But I looked in the money sack.
Just didn't look good enough. Do anything for you, sir?
You down, Brady?
Yeah.
I'm Moriarty, California Investigation Service. You bought a watch yesterday at Jay's Jewelers, didn't you?
Yeah, I did.
And took it straight to Uncle John's and hocked it.
What if I did?
Don't play dumb. Why would you buy a watch for $100 and hock it the same day for $30?
Well, I...
Because you don't intend to pay the $100, that's why.
Now, wait a minute. Don't holler before you're hurt, pal. I signed up to pay that thing $10 a month. When the month's up, I'll pay him the $10.
Oh, no, you won't. Because J. Jewelers don't think you're going to be here when the month's up. They think you're going to skip town. So you'll pay up now or Jay's going to swear out a warrant.
Warrant? Warrant for what?
I'll give it to you in words of one syllable, my friend. When you buy something on the installment plan, you sign what they call a conditional sales contract.
Yeah?
This contract says that the watch, the radio, or the easy chair don't belong to you until you make your last payment. It says that if you sell, mortgage, or hock something you don't own yet, you're guilty of larceny. And a $100 watch is grand larceny. That's 3 years in the penitentiary in this state.
You're kidding me, aren't you?
Kidding? Me? Not in your life. You signed a contract like this, didn't you?
Yeah.
Read what it says right there.
The debt is payable.
Within 24 hours, the charges will be brought.
Well, look, I can't get a hold of $100, I mean, just like that right away.
Well, you better dig it up somewhere. Because if you don't pay up by noon tomorrow, a little man's going to call on you with a big warrant. That's all, brother. Until noon tomorrow.
Hey, Chuck.
Yeah?
What does a guy do when he needs lots of dough?
Me, I usually hock my watch.
It's a great idea. Maybe I can get some dough on my jalopy. I wonder how much they'll give me for it. No, Dice. What good is $300? I still owe the finance company $350. By 8:30, I'd tried everything I could think of, and I still hadn't raised $100. I hadn't raised $1.25. So I threw in the towel and headed for Phil's place to knock off a couple of beers. The longer I sat on that silly stool, the more I felt like slugging somebody. I could have socked old man Mackey for being so tight. And the guy in the jewelry store for sending Moriarty after me. Or the fella standing next to me at the bar because he had money in his pocket and I didn't.
I'm Mr. Elliott, Phil Nixon.
360 short.
Okay, I gotta get home before the old lady chaps my ears off.
Haven't you got something smaller? This one's a fifth.
How's this one?
That's another 50. Here, let me look. There's a 5 right there on top.
Oh, this one.
Yeah.
Just keep the same. I gotta get home before the old lady slaps me down. Who?
Your wife.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, the old lady. Good night, Philzy.
So long, Shorty. How's a joker like that rate all that dough? Shorty, he runs the bingo game. And do the suckers keep him happy? Another beer, Danny?
Oh. So.
Hey, Romy, how is it?
Come on, Johnny, how is it?
Okay.
Oh, hang on, nice boy. Let me tell you a question. Maybe you got deep one to lay
alone, will you?
Oh, don't fall on your bench, you jerk.
I said a mule, his name is Cal. 15 miles on the Erie Canal. Where's the river? 15 miles on the Erie Canal. miles on the Erie Canal. You're a good old worker and a good old pal. 50 miles on the Erie Canal. He's a good old worker and a good old pal. 50 miles on the Erie Canal.
All right, reach, come on, I'm not kidding you. Let's go.
Chasing us, we've got all night, haven't we?
Sure we have. Maybe you've got all night. Me and Helen, we only got 5 minutes till the last show. Logan's the general.
Really, I almost forgot. I've already seen the picture. I saw it when it was downtown at the palace.
But you said...
Oh, I got it.
You wouldn't mind if I went alone,
would you?
No, I wouldn't mind.
I didn't think so.
Goodbye, then.
Bye.
Gee, Ben, this is like old times.
Yeah.
Let's go on the roller coaster and the chute and the dipper. Let's go on everything.
All right.
My knees were really shaking back there. I thought the cops would bust out of that alley any minute. Yeah, but now I'm in the clear. With heavy dough in my pocket, I can pay off that jewelry store and have enough left over to show Vera the biggest time she ever had. Vera. I've got a date with her tonight. I promised to meet her at Nick's place.
What time is it?
It's 25 to 10.
Holy smoke, I promised to meet a guy a half hour ago. I'm kind of late. I'm sorry, kid. Can I walk you to the bus or something?
Well, you don't have to, Dan. I can get home by myself.
I'll give you a ring and we'll get together sometime soon. I'll see you later, sir.
Don't come back. I want my $50.
Do me a favor, will you? Drop dead.
Take the journey and travel home. Take your hands off
my wife.
Did you hear me?
I don't like to be pushed around. I just don't.
Hang your head!
Oh, it's all this about $50.
It wasn't a loan, it was a present.
I don't want you taking $50 from a guy like this ever. Let's get out of here.
Tell me what we're celebrating.
Supposed to be celebrating something?
Could be.
Last night you were spending dollar bills, and tonight it's 50s.
I won at the crap game.
You sure it wasn't bingo?
Two champagne cocktails.
What do you mean, bingo?
Just thought you might have won it from Shorty McCabe.
I'll give you that idea.
Maybe it was Evelyn.
Evelyn? Who's Evelyn?
Bookkeeper in the movie house. She saw Shorty lose it in the auto park.
What do you know about this?
She just came into Nick's place to phone the cops.
Cops? What'd she say?
Vera, long time no see. How about a dance?
No, thanks.
Your boyfriend won't mind.
No, thanks.
Can I buy you both a drink?
No.
Isn't there anything I can do for you?
Yeah, blow.
You heard her.
Said you saw the guy who did it with a handkerchief around his face. He took Shorty for his bankroll. Didn't he?
How do I know?
Just thought you might have heard about it. Anyhow, if it was me, and I'd won any $50 bills, I wouldn't go spending them around the pier.
Yeah? Why not?
Because everyone around here knows that Shorty carries 50s.
Look, I don't know any guy named Shorty, and I won this dough in a crap game, see?
Oh, now, sure you did. Sure you did, Danny. Let's spend some of it, huh?
That's more like it.
Only, we won't spend the 50s, will we?
No, we won't spend the 50s.
$40, $60, $80, $100. There's $100. Here's your dough.
There's your contract.
So long, Brady.
So long.
Back A motor. Who? This is him speaking. How'd I like to what? How'd you like to take a big jump off the pier?
No, I don't like to take a jump off the pier. But you better come and see me or else.
Or else what?
Or else something is going to happen. To you. To you, Danny boy.
On your mind, and it better be good.
Oh, it's very good. You know, last night a prize fighter, a big prize fighter, he left something here. I picked it up. Picked it up where you left it. It's got a knot in it. You know, like you use for a mask or something.
I don't know what you're talking about.
No?
No. But I'll take it just for luck.
Sure, sure. You keep my handkerchief. Same knot, only your handkerchief had blood on it.
So what?
Did you ever hear anybody say money talks? $50 bills. They talk very loud. It's big bills. What do they say? It says Shorty McCabe, Shorty McCabe. Yeah, that's what it says. Shorty McCabe.
What's your angle? What are you trying to tell me?
I'm telling you about a holdup. You see, Evelyn from the picture show, she saw the man get robbed, and she got a very good look at the guy who did it. She thinks she can identify him very easy. Nice girl. You want me to call her?
Wait a minute. Put it down. If you're so sure that I was mixed up in this thing, why don't you call the cops?
Cops? Oh, no. I'm a businessman. See, Danny boy, I think I can do business with you very nice.
What kind of business do you think you could do with me?
Automobile business. You get me a new car and I don't know nothing. Just nothing.
A new car? I couldn't get a new car if I wanted to.
Oh, Well, you can get a new car. Same way you got the $50 bill.
Are you nuts?
Nuts? Me? No, I don't think so.
Davis?
Yes?
Here's a place for the green sedan. See that it's ready for delivery in the morning.
Yep.
Oh, and Davis, don't let me catch you putting in 10 gallons of gas this time. 6 is plenty.
Yes, sir.
There goes the last new car we'll have this month. I've got to get it tonight or blow town tomorrow. Even if I blow town, they'll probably catch up with me. Oh, boy, am I in a mess.
Hey, Dan.
Dan, I was just thinking if you're not going to take Helen out anymore, I thought maybe I'd give her a call sometime.
Yeah, sure. Why don't you do that, Chuck?
Hi, everybody. I'm Mickey Rooney, Jr.
And I'm his brother, Tim Rooney.
You know, if the name Rooney sounds familiar, it's because our father, Mickey Rooney, made it famous.
And here's another name that soon will be famous, the Western Eagle Foundation.
Based in Temecula, California, with hundreds of thousands of pounds of donated food, feeds some 200,000-plus persons monthly.
You can reach us at Western Eagle Foundation at 909-695-7206.
Hope somebody finds the restrooms really quick.
This is intriguing.
Yeah. Oh, yes. Hey, welcome back to Dumpsterpiece Theater. We're enjoying tonight's movie, Quicksand. We hope you are, too. Actually, I believe you're finding now that we've actually found a decent film for you to watch, which is uncharacteristic of this show. Any of the steady viewers would say so, anyway.
A forgotten treasure at that.
Oh, yes. I would say so. Speaking of forgotten treasures, we're going to do our DVD pick of the week. And
John gets to pick the DVD pick of the week every week.
Oh, yes. But one of these days, we have to get to Alfonso doing that and stuff. You got favorite DVDs, don't you?
I don't have many DVDs.
Okay, well, we'll have Alfonso's pick next week, darn it. Anyway, what we're doing, since we're celebrating film noir tonight, here is an item that's going to be hard to find after a while. This is from the Rowan Group. And Cary Rowan is, apparently he's rather ill, so he had to, like, sell his organization. So this is going to be a very hard to find thing. This is the film noir of Anthony Mann. It features three titles, T-Men, Raw Deal, and the best known of the three, He Walked by Night, starring Richard Basehart as a cop killer in Los Angeles. These are three films that were made in the...
Cop killer, mother!
Yeah, exactly. But he's a really subtle cop killer. I mean, if all you people remember Richard Basehart from Voyage to the Bottom of the Sea, forget it. This is like really fine acting from Basehart, and probably one of his finest moments on the early screen. But all of these are directed by Anthony Mann, who later went on to do a series of psycho westerns in the 50s. He started all that weird stuff. But in the 40s, when these films came out, 46, 47, that time period, Mann was directing these films. And T-Men was part of the pseudo-documentary style that was starting to be influenced, and has kind of sparked the neo-realist movement that the Italians were starting, of Vittorio De Sica, those kind of people, starting to use real locations, and He Walked by Night certainly reflects that. There's a lot of great L.A. locations in this. It ends in the L.A. sewer drains, and there's some really moody photography by John Alton, who is like one of my favorite cinematographers. He's done a lot of really great, uncharacteristic, shadowy, chiaroscuro films, which are just wonderful to watch. And these three are no exception. I could go rattle on and on and on about these, but if you like the crime film and film noir genres, check these out, because they're among the best films and the most highly sought films, actually. And keep an eye on this, because you're not going to be able to find this after a while. Rowan Group has gone out of business. They've sold all of their territory, so you have no idea who is going to get this, if anybody. And it's very worthwhile.
Go check Amazon or something.
Exactly, and it may start costing you a fortune. You never know.
Snap them up.
Yes indeed. So anyway, Film Noir by Anthony Mann, and check it out. Really worthwhile. Well, Alfonso, I'm kind of enjoying this Film Noir thing. This is kind of fun.
Yeah, me too.
Yeah. Speaking of which, I guess we ought to get back to this one. Quicksand, starring Mickey Rooney, Jeannie Cagney, Barbara Bates, and I'm not going to do the imitation, but Mr. Lorre. I hope you're enjoying his performance in this. He's way over the top. I think we're getting into the segment now where Lorre's starting to put the finger on Dan. He's going to want him to start doing more rotten and nefarious things. Better find out what it is right here on Dumpsterpiece Theatre.
Yeah.
Hey, fella. This thing is stuck back here. Green sedan, the second in California Street. It's got license plates.
That's fine. Well, I promise you, I know nothing. Absolutely nothing.
Wait. What's the matter? I want the handkerchief.
Yeah. You let go of this, and I'll
let go of
it.
I'll let go.
Okay.
What are you going to do with the car?
It's none of your business, Danny boy. Well, I'll tell you, I sold it to a gambler friend of mine. He's driving it home to Nevada.
I don't want
him
around town here, so I'll be
getting
in the gym.
Don't worry, he's going home tonight.
No slip-ups.
Okay.
Who took that green sedan?
Yeah. Dill?
Yeah. I could tell the police about it right this minute. But I don't know whether that would help me get back the car or not. You understand?
No, I don't.
Now, I'm not interested in sending anybody to jail, Brady. I'm interested in getting back that car.
I don't know why you're telling me all this, Mr.
Oh, yes, you do. An employee of this firm stole that sedan. And I happen to know who it is because he was seen.
Oh. You're trying to pin this thing on me, Mr.
Don't try to run any bluffs, Brady.
How many times do I have to tell you?
You don't have to tell me anything. All you have to do is to get that car down here parked out in front before I get down tomorrow.
What if I haven't got it? What if I don't know where it is?
But you did have it, and you do know where it is.
Well, I don't anymore.
If you can't return the car, you'll have to pay for it. $3,000.
$3,000? Right. That only lists for $1,950.
You don't think I'd sell to you at list.
$3,000. Where would a guy like me get any dough like that?
Almost everybody's got a family someplace. Well, folks would go to a lot of trouble to keep a man out of jail.
Not mine.
Now, look, I'll give you 24 hours, Brady. I want the money or I want the automobile. Now, let me give you some warning. Don't you try to leave town.
$3,000. It might as well have been $3 million. I tried to remember who could have seen me in the green sedan. Nobody'd known I had it except Nick. Nick. Maybe that was who told the old man. Nick hated me. He'd cut my throat for a nickel.
Hey. What's the matter with you tonight? You look like you lost your last friend.
How'd you like to go to Texas, honey, right now, right away?
Are you kidding?
I'm on the level.
Uh-huh. What's the matter with California? Weather getting too warm?
Tell you about it later. So I'm in a worse jam than ever. My boss is going to throw me in the brig if I don't get a hold of $3,000 or else. Where am I going to get a hold of $3,000?
I know where there's $3,000 or $4,000.
Yeah, First National Bank.
No, not in any bank. But we can get at it. We can get at it easy. All you have to do is to break a little catch lock on a rickety old door. You could pry it open with your fingernails.
Not with my fingernails. I'm in too deep already.
This is the end of the month. That's when Nick keeps the money overnight.
Nick? You mean Nick at the Penny Arcade?
Uh-huh. There'll be thousands of dollars there tonight.
What would Nick be doing with that kind of dough?
He charges people for cashing checks. Today's a big payday. A lot of them will bring their checks in the morning before the bank's open. And he doesn't even have a safe. He hides it. I know where.
It was Nick who got me into all this.
Let Nick get you out. Then you won't have to go to Texas. You can stay here with me.
Wait a minute.
What's the matter?
Someone watching us from the house.
It's only old Snoop.
Who?
The landlady. She's always looking for trouble. You know, I had a news program on the air the other night, and she busted in and tried to tell me I had a man in my room.
She's still watching.
Well, let's give her something to watch. Stay out here and look out for the watchman. If I see him coming, I'll honk the horn.
Blow it 3 times so I'll know it's you.
All right, then. Good luck.
money?
Yeah.
I heard shooting. What happened?
The night watchman saw me.
Well, you took a big chance tonight and you got away with it. You ought to be tickled to death.
Well, I'm not. I feel like I'm being shoved into a corner, and if I don't get out soon, it'll be too late. Maybe it's too late already.
But you can stop worrying. You're out right now. You got the money in your pocket to pay your way out.
Yeah. Yeah, that's right. I've got the money. That'll square everything, all right.
I wonder how much there is.
Feels like a lot.
Let's take it up to my room and count it.
All right.
Down her shades. $500 in each of these packages. 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. $3,500. 20, 40, 60, 80, 90, 100, 110.
$3,610. Yeah, it's a lot of dough.
That's more money than I could make in a year working every day. What's the coppers?
Just like I thought.
What's the big idea? Who said you can come in?
I have rules in this house. This is a clean, respectable place.
Well, you got no right in here. Now get out.
I don't allow no men in the rooms. Not in my house. And I am not leaving until he goes.
You're leaving right now.
Maybe you'd rather I'd call the cops.
Why, you old bat
like... Cut it out, will you? We don't want any trouble, especially now.
Yeah, but...
Maybe I ought to go. You think you can take care of everything all right?
Oh. Yeah, sure, Danny. Don't worry. I can take care of everything.
I'll call you in the morning.
I don't want any of your kind around here. When your rent's up, you can move out.
Scram!
Hello, is Vera Novak there?
Hey, you're going to wear that thing out today.
Oh, this is a...
Why don't you forget about it? She's just
a minute, Dane. Will you do me a favor and shut up, please?
Sorry.
Oh, this is her day off. She wouldn't be at the restaurant. Look, when she comes in, would you tell her to call Dan Brady at Mackey Motor? It's very important. As soon as she comes in. All right. Thank you.
Well, Brady?
Well?
I didn't see that green sedan when I came down this morning.
No, you didn't, did you?
Does that mean you can't get it back?
You mean anything you want it to be?
Well, then I assume you intend to pay for the car instead.
Oh, do you?
How long will it take you to get the money?
I've got it already.
Yeah?
Yeah.
Fine. Why don't you come right into the office?
Well, then? I haven't got it on me. I have to pick it up tonight after work. I can bring it in the morning.
Why wait till tomorrow? I'll come right back after dinner tonight. You can see me in the office then.
Well, might be 10 o'clock or so.
It's all right, Brady. It's perfectly all right. See you tonight.
Mackey Motor. Hello, Vera. Where have you been? Did you take care of everything all right? Good. Well, that's swell, baby. Look, I'll be over and see you tonight as soon as I get off work, right after 6 o'clock. Goodbye.
That you, Danny?
Yeah.
Come right in. Beautiful, Danny. Oh, Danny. Danny, I might never have had it if it hadn't been for you.
Where'd you get the coat?
I bought it.
Bought it with what?
With my share of the money. Here's your end. $1,800.
You took half that dough and bought a coat with it?
Not just a coat, Danny, a mink coat.
You sold me out.
Oh, now, just a minute. Who told you where the money was? Who told you how to get it? Isn't that worth half?
I can't use half. I need 3,000.
Oh, don't be a chump. Nobody expects to get everything you ask for. Make him an offer. That's what I did.
What you did?
Sure. Now, this coat cost $2,000. I told the furrier $1,800 was all I had and he could take it or leave it. took it. Offer this to the old man. Tell him it's all you could raise. I bet anything he takes.
Glad you're doing the sensible thing. There's only 1,800 here.
That's right.
Where's the rest of it?
I couldn't dig it up. Take it or leave it.
I'll take it. Me the police station.
What's the idea?
I told you I'd forget about the whole thing for $3,000, but not for $1,800. Now, if you've got the rest of it on you, you'd better pay me now before it's too late.
Why, are you...
Danny, I missed your quitting time tonight. I wanted to say goodbye.
Goodbye?
Yeah, I quit today. I'm through with that screwball Mackie. I told you what he tried to pull on me, didn't I?
No, no, you didn't.
Well, you remember the night the sedan disappeared? Well, the next morning, he called me in his office and tried to tell me I swiped it.
Said what?
Like I'm telling you, he said I stole the car. Gave me a lot of hooey about somebody seeing me drive away.
Wait a minute, I'm all mixed up. Let me get this thing straight. He said that he saw you drive that car away?
And that he knew. Yesterday, he called me in his office, and he had some screwy idea I should get $3,000 for my old man to pay for the sedan. Now, how nuts can a guy get?
He didn't know anything at all. He was just fishing around, putting the pressure on everybody, hoping something would turn up.
Yeah, I should have let him have one talking to me like that. Some of these days, that old man is going to get his neck in a sling.
Neck in a sling? Yeah. Hey, he had it coming, though, didn't he? Was trying to outsmart everybody, but he got too smart. Yeah, he got so smart, he got his neck in a sling.
Oh! 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 Danny, what is it? What's the matter?
I have a date here. I'm late already.
Come in. How'd it go? Did he take the money?
Yeah, he took it.
I told you he would.
Pack your things. We gotta get out of here.
What are you talking about?
He tried to call the cops. I had to stop him.
Stop him? How?
Never mind. Pack your things.
Stop clowning, Danny. How?
I'm not clowning. He tried to call the cops. I had to take the phone away from him. He pulled a gun on me. I strangled him.
On the level?
On the level. Look, they won't find him until in the morning. By that time, we'll be halfway to Texas, baby.
You'll be halfway to Texas. Not me.
But the cops will be after us.
They won't be after me. I don't have to run away.
Look, we're in this thing together. You told me to offer him the dough.
I didn't tell you to kill him. And I wasn't there when it happened. So why should I stick my neck out now?
What kind of a dame are you?
The kind that watches out for herself. If I didn't, who would?
Well, you don't care about anybody else, do you?
Why, sure I do. I wouldn't want to see anything happen to you, Danny. Certainly wouldn't want to see the cops catch you. Don't you think you better get started to Texas? I'll kiss you goodbye if you want me to.
Or I would dirty my lips.
One more bite.
Miss Novak, some gentlemen to see you.
You there, Novak?
Well, what if I am?
Got something for you.
Yeah? What is it?
A search warrant. See what she's got in her purse, Smitty.
Find him in there.
Won't find who in there?
You know who. Dan Brady.
Oh, yeah, Dan Brady. Where will I find him?
He's getting out of the state as fast as he can drive.
Why aren't you getting out, too?
I didn't have any part of it. I didn't even know him.
Didn't know who?
Say, are you trying to make me look like a fool? Mackie, of course.
Mackie? Which Mackie is that?
Oh, the one that ran the automobile agency.
Ran?
Well, he can't keep on running it now that he's dead, can he?
Dead? Who's dead? Mackie, of course. Brady killed him. The girl didn't have any part of it. Where did it happen?
You know where. At the automobile... Say, are you trying to kid me?
Sure. Maybe it's the other way around. Maybe you're trying to kid me. Why did you start spilling the minute I came in the door? Maybe it's because you wanted me to think your boyfriend had gone when he hadn't. How do I know he isn't still here?
Why didn't you look under the couch?
I don't suppose he'd be that near. No, I didn't think he'd be that close. Smitty. Watch it.
Ha, ha, ha.
Ha, ha, ha. Where does a dame like you get a coat like this?
I bought that coat with my own money. You take your dirty hands off it.
I'll bet you did.
I can prove it. I got a receipt. Here.
Alaska Couriers, 917 Main Street. Received a Vera Novak, $1,800. Well, looks like Nick had the right hunch, Schmidt.
Nick?
What do you suppose brought us here? Last night somebody stole $3,600 of Nick's money, and today you paid $1,800 for a fur coat. Looks like you and your boyfriend split Nick's bankroll right down the middle.
I don't know what you're talking about. Give me back my coat.
Don't worry about your coat, sister. We'll take it right with us. Bring her along, Smitty, and we'll check on Mackie on the way down to the station.
Serve you right, you hussy.
You're up dead.
Oh, yeah. Welcome back to Dumpsterpiece Theater, the show that's trying to keep B-movies alive and keep you awake for 2 hours, or so we hope.
I thought it was bringing the drive-in straight to your living room.
That's right.
And without screeching, the oil spots and gravel.
Yeah, and burning out on the carpet. Yeah. Well, the dogs do
the
that.
The dog would do that.
Yeah. Ooh. Oh, well, we're thinking the same way. Oh, well. back to our show anyway. You're right in the middle. Actually, you're getting towards the dramatic conclusion, I should say, of...
The climax, if you will.
Quicksand with Mickey Rooney, Jeannie Cagney. I think by now, folks, you're getting the idea that Vera is not a really good woman for Dan here. You know, she's like taking him for a ride. Of course, now this thing is snowballing and escalating to the point to where this guy's going to have to run for his life. And is he going to drop the B-girl? Is he going to save his relationship with Helen, the girl who loves him no matter what? Well, those are questions you're going to have to answer later on. Oh, what, Al?
Well, you know, I was thinking all this time that we've seen this movie before. And, well, not before, but we've seen this movie remade.
Yes, I'd say there's a few.
I think several times. But what comes to mind is that Griffin Dunn film with...
After Hours.
After Hours, yeah, the Marty Scorsese film.
Yeah, one of his rare comedies, which I think Scorsese needs to make more of. Very good point, Alfonso. Now,
This guy's night keeps getting worse and worse.
And of course, Scorsese, being a big film noir fan, I mean, Force of Evil, films like that are among his favorite films, so there was absolutely no reason why he wouldn't do a noirish film. The fact that he made it a very bizarre comedy is even more fun. So, yeah, there are parallels to that. An innocent guy going through one night of hell. It's roughly 24 hours of living hell. Where in this film, Mickey Rooney has to have it extended for a while. So he goes through all kinds of tortures. It just takes a little while longer. Hey, you know how that goes.
Mm.
Well, anyway, what we'd like to talk to about, is one of the more striking features of most film noir, is atmospheric photography. Tonight's cinematographer is Lionel Linden. And I believe he does a fairly decent job of capturing not only the Santa Monica Pier before the fire. Guys, well, I mean, this is a piece of history right here. So it's nice to see all those locations, the whip and things like that. Long gone now. Long gone. Aren't they like...
Well, they got this thing up there now, but you wouldn't want to go there.
Yeah, it's kind of the pier. It has a merry-go-round and a couple of fun places to hang out, but not like it used to be. I mean, Santa Monica Pier used to be a wonderful spot, but and I think the photography of tonight's film captures that very well. There's other, you know, nice little atmospheric beat shots. When we get to the
arcade.
The arcade is a lot of fun. Now, the obligatory chase scene towards the end of the film, which we'll get to here shortly, has some really nice photography in it. You'll see what I mean. You just keep an eye out on the way that Linden frames his shots here of Rooney running away from the law. Great stuff. This is the kind of thing that really makes films of this type exciting, and why films today are they just don't really do it for me, you know. I'll see two or three films a year that are worth a look, but how about you, Alf? Are you kind of like, I'm kind of getting worn on some of this crap. That
gone to death.
Exactly. All digital effects and no story, which I guess is okay for some people. It makes money, but Hollywood, come on.
Hey, if you like car chases, there's Chips on late night TV.
Really. I'd rather watch Chips than the Fast and the Furious or stuff like that. I like Vin Diesel, but, you know, hey, I'd rather watch Ponch and John. Who, what?
Vin Diesel? You got to read the tabloids.
Uh-oh. That's what comes with fame, Vinny, you know. Sorry, that happens.
You just go shine that bald head of yours.
Yeah, exactly. We'll leave that to the viewers. You know, like they say on Fox, the viewer makes up their mind right here. So that's it. I guess we're diverting enough to the point where we ought to get back to the movie and the exciting climax of Quicksand. Run for your life, Mickey.
What are you doing here?
I could see you were in trouble, so I got rid of Chuck and came down.
Get yourself right back home. I gotta get out of here quick.
What is it, dear? Was it the hole up in the auto store?
What do you know about that hole?
I saw you hiding in the alley that night. The night that Millie and I walked by. I couldn't see your features, but I knew that it was you. But then I thought maybe I was imagining things. You know how it is when you love someone. You think you see him 50 times a day. But a minute later, you called my name, and I turned around, and there you were at the head of the alley. Then we heard about the holdup in the auto park, and I saw the look on your face.
Is that all?
That's all.
Well, why don't you get out? Let me get started.
I saw the police come out of the house with her. Are they after you two?
What if they are? What business is of yours?
But I can help you. I can tell them you were with me all evening, and you'll have an alibi.
I don't get it. Why do you want to help me? When things were going my way, all I ever gave you was a runaround. Now that I'm in a jam, why don't you get smart and stay away from me?
I've been away from you too long, and it isn't any good. Don't you think I know I'm dumb to throw myself at a guy that doesn't want me? Don't you think I know I'm a fool to stand on a street corner for an hour just waiting for you to come out of a door? I know all that, but I can't help it. I fell in love with you the first time I saw you, Ted.
I'll drive you home. It's less than a week since Helen waited for me outside the garage. Have you been dancing lately, she said? And all I had to do was say, swell idea, let's go out tonight. If I'd have said that, I wouldn't be running away from the cops tonight with a murder hanging over my head.
No, dear. No.
Hey, buddy, pull over to the curb. Take a look at your driver's license. Brady. That's your name?
Yes, sir.
You went through a boulevard stop back there. Will you sign this?
Yes.
And take it easy.
Yeah. Helen, you kept me from making an awful mistake.
Well, if you'll only take me with you, I can help you. I know I can.
Let me lay it on the line. I'm going to have to keep running. I'm going to have to keep running all my life because when they catch up with me, they're going to hang me.
Hang you?
For murder. I killed a man tonight.
Start the car, then tell me how it happened.
Telling her about it wasn't as hard as I thought it'd be. That was Helen who came up with the idea of Mexico. We decided to head for an inland town like Hermosillo, where not many tourists come. A man could be safe for 50 years in a place like that.
What's that?
That's goodbye to Mexico. Oh, it's the main bearing. It'll take a couple of days to fix.
Well, then we'll have to hitchhike.
And get there by morning, we'd never make it.
We have to make it.
Oh, Helen, I've had the right girl all the time and was too dumb to know about it. If we ever get out of this thing...
We're going to get out of it.
Yeah, but how? I've got an idea. This is the baby that's going to get us there.
Well, what are you going to do with that?
Get us a lift, honey. A lift straight through to Mexico. Come on. Careful. Try any funny stuff. I don't want to hurt you. All right. When the signal changes, get going. Turn south on the highway. Keep her under 50 and don't go through any red lights. You understand me?
May I ask where we're going?
Just keep driving. You'll find out.
I suppose you know what you're getting into. This isn't a car theft. It's kidnapping.
No one asked you. I don't want your advice, you hear me?
Well, I happen to be a lawyer. Maybe...
Maybe you can keep your mouth shut, too.
No, Dan. Let him talk. He might be able to help us.
She's right. Whatever it is you're running away from, this is worse. Kidnapping is a capital offense. They can hang you for it.
What's the difference? They're gonna hang me anyway. I just killed a man.
How about the girl?
You leave her out of it. She had nothing to do with it. You understand me?
I believe that. But with the police. Look, son, I can see this girl means something to you. Why don't you tell me what happened? For her sake. She'll need a lawyer sooner or later.
Maybe you're right. If you're sure you could keep her in the clear.
If she's innocent, you tell me the whole story. And it's the truth.
Truth. I don't know where to begin.
Start at the beginning.
The guy was a lawyer. And maybe he could help Helen, so I told him the whole story. I told him about sticking up Shorty in the auto park and about breaking into the Penny Arcade in the middle of the night. I told him about Vera and Nick and old man Mackey. I told him everything that had happened, from the very beginning to the end.
I see. Now the first thing you want to know is where the girl stands.
That's right.
She's in the clear. They can't touch her.
Oh, but how about Dan? He said maybe it wouldn't be murder. It might be manslaughter.
No, it's murder, all right. I might be able to get him off with second degree. They'd have a hard time proving premeditation.
Second degree? That'd mean life, wouldn't it?
It could.
I'd rather they hung me.
There's one discrepancy in your story. It's worth checking up on, because if we get the right answer, murder's out. Manslaughter, too.
What do you mean?
How do you know he's dead?
Oh, he's dead, that's all. His head fell over on the desk like he was dead.
It would do that if he were unconscious. Did you feel his pulse or listen for a heartbeat?
No, I didn't.
Men don't die easily. They take a lot of killing. I can imagine Mackey sitting in a police station right now telling the desk man what a narrow escape he had.
If he only was alive. Helen, if he only was alive, I'd give myself up to the first cop that came along.
Here's an all-night restaurant. Why don't I use their phone to find out how Mackey is?
Why don't you keep on driving, too? I'll tell you how Mackey is. He's dead. That's what he's dead.
Oh, but Dan, maybe he is.
No, he is. I know he is. Listen, I didn't want to kill anybody. I don't want to kill you now, but if you try any more funny stuff, I'll blow a hole right through you. What day is this, Helen?
It's Saturday.
No, it isn't. It's Sunday morning. We still have a couple of hours before daylight. We can still make it. Turn this car around.
Where are we going now?
Remember Buzz Larson?
Yeah.
He's taking a fishing party way down past San Diego this morning. If we can get to the pier in time, I can go with him.
To Mexico?
Way past the Mexican border. Step on it, will you? Hope the boat is still here. Yeah. Yeah, there it is. Down there. We made it. I'd better hurry, not you.
Well, I'm going with you, Dan. I've got...
No harbor below San Diego. I'll have to swim in from the sea.
Well, I'm going with you, Dan.
You've taken too many chances already. I've got to go on by myself from here on. I'll send for you as soon as I get a job. You know that, don't you, baby?
Oh, yes, but... Oh, Dan, don't go. I'm so afraid.
There's nothing to be afraid of. Hey, wait a minute. Maybe there is. How are we going to keep this guy from going to the cops till after the boat pulls out of the harbor?
I'll keep him away. Give me the gun.
I wouldn't do that if I were you.
Why not?
I told you the girl was in the clear. She won't be if she takes that gun. After that, she'll be an accessory.
Oh, don't listen to him, Dan. No. You've got to get away from
him. No, he's right. You've got to be kept out of this. That's all that's important now.
Would you take my word for something?
I might.
As a citizen, I have to notify the police. But as a friend, I don't have to hurry.
Thanks. Would you do me another favor?
If I can.
Don't wait until the boat pulls out of the harbor. Leave now.
I'll get her out of here right away.
Thanks.
Brady since noon Monday.
No, I haven't.
And you haven't heard from him either?
Nope. Wait a minute, I just remembered. He called me Monday afternoon.
For any particular reason?
Yeah, I owed him $20. He said he needed it.
There's a news broadcast at 6 o'clock. I want to hear before I talk to the authorities.
Guarding every airport, every bus depot, and every railroad station in a determined effort to prevent the killer's escape. At 4 o'clock this morning, officers threw roadblocks across both state highways and are now stopping all outbound cars. But at last reports, McDonald was still at large.
McDonald?
Meanwhile, police officers Truxton and Chandler are dead, and Deputy Sheriff Alan P. Janus was taken to the emergency hospital with two bullets in his thigh.
I'd get it a little louder.
Closer to home, beat city authorities are seeking garage mechanic Daniel Brady, 26, an employee of the Mackey Motor Company. Late yesterday evening, watchman Michael J. O'Brien, while making his regular nightly rounds, discovered the unconscious body of Orrin Mackey, president of the automobile agency, lying in his office. Mackey regained consciousness at St. Mark's Hospital shortly after midnight and named Brady as his assailant.
What? He's alive.
Tom, you want to watch yourself before you run into that kid, okay?
What's dangerous about him?
Got Mackey's gun. Put him in the car and I'll drive him straight to the hospital. That's all right with you?
Certainly.
Save much time instead of waiting for the ambulance. I wouldn't have shot you only. I thought you had a gun. What'd you do with it?
I dropped it. What do you think they're going to give me?
Have you ever been in trouble before?
No, never.
Well, I think we can rule out the watch and the $20 bill. They probably charge you with the holdup, stealing the car, and breaking you to the Penny Arcade. That could add up to anything from 1 to 10 years. But since you're a first offender, my guess is that it'll be nearer 1 than 10.
Whatever it is, I'll take it.
Whenever it is, I'll be waiting for you, Dan. If you want me to.
You're a great gal, Helen.
I love you, Dan.
That goes both ways.
Hot pizza by the slice. Yummy.
Well, you better tell them it's almost the end of the movie and they better come and get their cold pizza by the slice.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, it'll be cold by the time you get here. Anyway, that was Quicksand starring Mickey Rooney. Now, wasn't that a lot of fun?
I like it!
Now, what I like about that film is it starts off, you know, kind of like, you know, the character introduction, stuff like that. All of a sudden, it just starts wham, 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 and crap starts happening to him, and oh, whoa, Quicksand of the title, and a reasonably optimistic ending for a film noir, so...
If not believable.
Yeah, yeah. Some of it was a little stretchy. Now, when Moriarty came in and started really hitting him the next day about, oh, well, you sold a watch at the pawn shop, you're going to pay for that. That was stretching it a little bit, but hey, what the heck? It was all right. I enjoyed it nonetheless. What I really like about this film and what I strongly still believe as a film historian is the fact that I really think that Mickey Rooney found a nice niche at this time period, and critics just did not appreciate it or pick it up. It took literally 10, 20 years down the line in his later days when he won an Emmy for Bill, you know, the TV film where he played a...
Card.
Yeah, exactly. And what an incredible performance that was. So, you know, Hollywood has a tendency to take its actors that they think is a little out of date or not quite box office anymore and just crap all over them. And here's Rooney. He comes back 20 years later after they think he's long gone, wins an Emmy, ha-ha. And,
I don't know, I like Black Beauty.
Black Beauty, the Black Stallion, actually.
Don't ever tell anyone I like Black Beauty.
Okay,
secret cannot leave this room.
Okay.
No one else is going to hear about this, right?
Your secret's safe with me, Alfonso. So anyway, that's it. I really am glad we got to show this because we got to see an entertainer who wanted to change his stripes. I mean, how many MGM musicals can you do with Judy Garland? Although he did several, and he was famous for Andy Hardy. And Strike Up the Band is still one of my favorite films. But, Quicksand is a very strong performance. And
Quicksand, quick ass!
Yeah. And I'll tell you what, if you look around the old video shelves and you look hard enough, you'll find The Atomic Kid, which was produced by Rooney in 53 or 4, I believe it was, from a screenplay by Blake Edwards. It's about a guy who gets blown up in an atomic accident and becomes some kind of super guy. It's a lot of fun.
Funny.
It's a lot of fun. It's with good old droopy beagle face Robert Strauss as his buddy. And it's a lot of fun. So, you know, for all the critics who dissed Rooney back then, hey, video is going to bring this stuff back and it's going to prove just how wrong they were. So there. Take that, you guys.
Yeah.
So that was it for Dumpsterpiece Theater for tonight. Now, what we'd like to remind you of is...
We're taking requests!
Yes, indeed. So sure that you check out our website or even contact us at the post office box. And if there's a film, particularly an old film that you want to see, drop us a line. Let us know. If we can show it, if it's in the public domain, we will show it.
Yeah, we got to know what you want to watch.
Yeah. In the meantime, you're going to be stuck with crap like Voodoo Man with George Zucco, John Carradine, Bela Lugosi. That's coming up pretty soon. Let's see. Not of This Earth, a long-lost Roger Corman film from 1956 with one of my favorites, Paul Birch, as the alien Mr. Johnson. Look into my eyes. My eyes are alien.
Carry On Screaming?
Yes.
We're
trying to get Carry On Screaming, probably the most watchable of the Carry On series out of England. Let's see, we'll be showing, we're going to be showing He Walked by Night sometime soon. That is in the public domain, and that's a wonderful film. So, you know, we get into the film noir mood every now and then, we're going to do it. So, just keep that address in mind and write us, doggone it. We get lonely over here, and we want to know what you want to see, besides the same old crap. Don't send us a letter and say, I want to see the same old crap. That won't work. Get specific. Send us titles.
Actually, I was talking to a guy the other day who wanted to see Master of the Flying Guillotine again.
Oh, well, we'll dig that one out of the archives when we start showing some reruns, and we'll dig that one out, because that was one of our more popular shows at the time, I think.
That's when those guys, like, took our voices?
Yeah, that was a lot of fun. Those were the days. The good old live days.
Good times.
So, that's in the future. the future being the past.
Yeah, being the past. Yes. Since it's a rerun.
So anyway, instead of being redundant, we're going to cut off tonight's show by saying thank you for watching Dumpsterpiece Theater.
Yeah, thanks a lot, kids.
Yes, you make our lives worth living, at least for 2 hours anyway.
Yeah.
The rest of it, we have to put up with the same daily crap that you guys do. Probably even worse, maybe, huh, Alfonso?
I wouldn't know.
I wouldn't either. Anyway, good night out there, all you B-movie fans.
Yeah, you so-and-sos and so-and-sos. Pass the ketchup.
Here you go.
Thank you.
He gave emotion as she wanted first. He gave devotion as she wanted first. She told him love and kissing, well baby they leave something missing. He gave her furs, he gave affection, well, she wanted pearls, not just rejection of all his other girls. She said, though arms enfold me, they cannot hold me. Oh. He gave her furs. And then a house in the country, a maid, a car, and more, and more, and more. Well, she was really good at living, always taking, never giving, till he asked himself, what for? Now first embrace her instead of arms. Those pearls that face her reflect no charms, while other wives are busy. She cries, where is he? The tea is bitter in her cup. The man that loved her, really loved her, he gave her a...
I really fooled you on that one, didn't I?
Had you laughing at the beginning? Any of you gentlemen get caught that way? Well, we've got a lucky bunch here tonight. Lucky bunch.